This is the day the Lord has made. I want to welcome you to worship here at Gloria Dei on this very eventful Sunday. Not only are we celebrating the rite of confirmation, but we're also celebrating our graduates. So lots of fun things to give thanks for and to be joyous about. Here are some actual gems taken from examination papers written by students. A census taker is a man who goes from house to house, increasing the population. An active verb shows action, a passive verb shows passion. A triangle which has an angle of 135 degrees is called an obscene triangle. One of the main causes of dust is janitors. The four seasons are salt, pepper, mustard, and vinegar. Syntax is all the money collected by the church for sins. Henry VIII, by his own efforts, increased the population of England by 40,000. The kinds of blood vessels are arteries, veins, and caterpillars. I thought that was pretty good. Abstinence is a good thing if practiced in moderation. And the wind is like the air, only pushier. Hey, let's take a moment to turn to our neighbor to our left and right, tell them how glad we are that they're here today. Special thank you to Sarah for filling in today, since Rebecca couldn't be here. Following our service, we have a reception planned in the fellowship hall, and we've got lots of great food, so we hope that you stick around for that. And again, celebrate our graduates and our confirmands. Right now, I'm going to invite you to stand as we join in our opening hymn.
God of grace, amazing wonder, here is irresistible fruit of the miracle of mercy. Jesus reaches down to me. God of grace, my standing wonder, as my God restores my soul. His own blood has paid my ransom. Awesome.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Glory to God, glory to God, glory. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
I invite you to join me in the prayer of the day. We pray together. All-powerful God, in Jesus Christ you turn death into life and defeat into victory. Increase our faith and trust in him that we may triumph over all evil in the strength of the same, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The congregation may be seated, and at this time I'd like to invite the confirmation students to come forward. After 2 years of instruction and hopefully some growth in their spirituality and faith, these three young people are ready to make the next step and affirm the faith in which they were baptized when they were younger, okay? And so we're quite excited for them today. And before we begin, we're going to just quickly ask each of them, what's been a highlight for you of the last 2 years?
I think the highlight for me was connecting with God more.
Okay.
That, but especially with people my age.
Mm-hmm.
I think that too, but with my sister in the first year.
Fantastic. I'm going to invite the congregation to turn with us to page 234. Let us pray. Merciful God, we thank you for these sisters and brothers whom you have made your own by water and the word in baptism. You have called them to yourself, enlightened them with the gifts of your Spirit, and nourished them in the community of faith. Uphold your servants in the gifts and promises of baptism, and unite the hearts of all whom you have brought to new birth. We ask this in the name of Christ. Amen. I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God? If so, respond by saying, I renounce them. Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God? And do you renounce the ways of sin that draw you away from God? And this is where the congregation joins us. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. You have made public profession of your faith. Do you intend to continue in the covenant God made with you in holy baptism, an event you probably don't remember, but now today you are affirming, to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. If so, you're going to individually respond with these words, I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
This time I'd like to invite you to come over to the step and to go ahead and kneel. Oh, the other way. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit you give us new birth, cleanse us from sin, and raise us to eternal life. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Noah the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving. Give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. Amen. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Ben the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. Amen. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Alyssa the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in her serving, give her patience in suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. Amen. You can stand up and turn around. Let us rejoice with these sisters and brothers in Christ. There's a little script for you there. We rejoice with you in the life of baptism. Together we give thanks and praise to God and proclaim the good news to all the world. Let's give them a nice warm welcome.
The first lesson for today is from the third chapter of Genesis. Immediately after Adam and Eve eat the forbidden fruit, they hide from God. Neither takes responsibility for their sin, instead blaming each other, the snake, and even God. The curse on the snake was understood as a messianic prophecy by the early church, who associated Eve's offspring with Christ. And now the reading beginning at the 8th verse. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." God said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers, and he will strike your head, and you will strike his heel." Here ends the lesson.
Our minds, our hearts, our lives.
The New Testament lesson for today comes from the fourth chapter of 2 Corinthians. Life in the present is transitory and cannot compare with the eternal home God has prepared for us. So we do not despair, no matter what life might bring, because we know that as God raised Jesus from the dead, God promises to bring us into eternal life. And now the reading, beginning at the 13th verse. But just as we have the same spirit of faith that is in accordance with Scripture, I believed and so I spoke, we also believe and so we speak, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and will bring us with you into his presence. Yes, everything is for your sake, so that grace, as it extends to more and more people, may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So we do not lose heart. Even though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure, because we look not at what can be seen, but what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Here ends the lesson.
For this third Sunday after Pentecost comes to us from Mark, the third chapter, beginning with the 20th verse.
Glory to you, Lord.
Hold on to your seats, folks. If you've been following along in Mark's gospel the last few weeks, you know that when Jesus started his ministry in Capernaum, it was controversial. He was casting out demons, performing healings at the wrong time, doing things that were upsetting folks. And in today's gospel, his family actually comes to try to take him away, put him back someplace safe, because he's really stirring things up, and it's quite an amazing story in terms of Jesus helping us to see the power of doing what God wants, even if that goes against the grain. Please join me in the reading of this gospel text. And the crowd came together again, so that they could not even eat. When his family heard it, they went out to restrain him, for people were saying, "He has gone out of his mind." And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem said, "He has Beelzebul, and by the ruler of the demons he casts out demons." And he called them to him and spoke to them in parables. How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand. But his end has come. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his property without first tying up the strong man. Then indeed the house can be plundered. Truly, I tell you, people will be forgiven for their sins and whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit can never have forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they had said, "He has an unclean spirit." Then his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. The crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, "Your mother and your brothers and sisters are outside asking for you." And he replied, "Who are my mother and my brothers?" And looking at those who sat around him, he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother. The Gospel of the Lord. Congregation may be seated.
Hey, Sarah, we're up.
I mean, she would sound good without me, but I wouldn't sound good without her.
In today's gospel, Mark tells us about the day when the immediate family of Jesus came to take him away in a straitjacket. The word on the street was that Jesus, was out of his mind. Taken quite literally, people thought he was beside himself. They claimed Jesus was possessed. And so his family came to his house to take Jesus away, because the popular opinion was that, again, he was insane. Boy, you don't often hear people talk about Jesus that way. That might sound like an odd assessment of Jesus' ministry, but it's central to how the Gospel of Mark portrays the work of Jesus. From the beginning, Jesus acted, well, he acted as if he were different, right? Jesus announced that God's reign had come near. He acted as if his view of the world was different from the world that we tend to take for granted. Consequently, Jesus was perceived as a threat and as a crazy person. It's embarrassing to hear people talk this way. Jesus, a madman? If so, what does that say about us, his followers? What does that say about each of us sitting in the pew here today? It's not very good PR. It's embarrassing. The gospel writers, Matthew and Luke, they were embarrassed. They borrow all sorts of stories from Mark when they write their gospels, but Matthew and Luke never say a word about this time in Jesus' life when his family came to take him away. And because, of course, they thought he was out of his mind. Better not to talk about those things. You don't want to give people the wrong idea that the person you're following is a madman, right? Jesus, as we know very well, told stories, crazy stories. A story of a vast treasure hidden in an ordinary field. A treasure so wonderful that if we were to catch a glimpse of it, we would cash in all the stocks and bonds as well as sell the lake house to hold that treasure for just an instant. He told of tiny seeds growing quietly, secretly, until they became great trees. And the trees became places of hospitality where all the birds could find a home and a place to roost. And he told stories of joyful homecomings, stories hinting to us that we might find ourselves a homecoming as well in this kingdom that we have not yet seen, but which we are already citizens. Crazy talk, no doubt about it. But talk that is contagious and illustrative of a vision of another reality which causes us to live differently. And of course, that's the point. Believe such words to be possible, and you will actually turn the world upside down. People will get upset and will probably claim that you are out of your mind, so be warned, but it is possible. The world can look different. Maybe that's what we are. Crazy cousins with our odd Uncle Jesus. When we live as if God's reign has already come, we find ourselves in a strange new family called church. These folks we're gathered with here today. Perhaps no one has seen the true social dimension of God's kingdom more clearly than Martin Luther King Jr. King confronted the evil house of racism with a clear word of gospel justice. His work provoked allegations against his own character and threats against his life. Yet he remained faithful to his vision until the day somebody shot him. The key, as he said in a number of his speeches, and this is kind of fascinating, was a certain maladjustment. I like that word. Maladjustment. There are certain things within our society to which I am proud to be maladjusted, and to which I call upon all of you to be maladjusted as well, right? If you allow the preacher in me to come out now, let me say to you that I never did intend to adjust to the evils of racism and discrimination. I never did intend to adjust myself to religious bigotry. I never did intend to adjust myself to economic conditions that will take necessities from the many to give luxuries to the few. and I never did intend to adjust myself to the madness of blind consumption and the self-defeating effects of unlimited use of fossil fuels. Okay? So when I talk about maladjustment, I'm talking about looking around the world that we live in, and where you see stuff that's not right, that's off, living differently, living true to what God's vision for this world is. So I call upon all of you, fellow apprentices of Jesus, to be maladjusted as well, because it may well be that the salvation of the world lies in the hands of the maladjusted. I know it's controversial, but that's the truth. So concluded King. Let us be as maladjusted as Jesus of Nazareth, who could look into the eyes of the men and women of his generation and cry out, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Pray for them that despitefully use you. Has the world changed? Nope. Every one of us must decide, just as Dr. King made his decision. We live our lives by the assumptions that we make. If we assume Jesus Christ has broken into the violence-prone, death-dealing house of evil, as Mark tells us, then we must act accordingly. A man named Bill happened to be a minister. He also has been accused of being a little bit crazy, out of his mind, okay? Bill does workshops for churches on clowning. Maybe you've heard of that ministry. Not long ago, he was in a distant city packing up after a workshop. The phone rang. Nobody was around, and so he answered. Are you a minister? Somebody asked. Well, yes, I actually am. Come quickly, the voice said. Our child is dying. Bill dropped everything. He ran out to his rental car and drove to the hospital. He parked the car, ran up the steps, through the double doors, and down the hall. And then, suddenly, it hit him. He was still dressed as a clown, with a white face, red nose, orange hair, and yellow suspenders. He didn't have time to change. This was an emergency. He kept going. He found the room, knocked on the door, and entered the room where a young girl in a hospital bed was surrounded by her family. Hey, we called for a minister, not a clown, said the father. But the daughter said, hey, he's better than a minister. Can he stay? No one dared to deny her request. Bill sat on the edge of the hospital bed. He sang songs. He told stories from Scripture. He cradled the little girl in his arms until the end. And when the last moment came, she made a request. Hey, would you come to my funeral? So that's how it happened. Crazy Bill stood with white face, red nose, blue hair, and suspenders. He never spoke a word. Yet he led the people as they laughed and cried and remembered this little girl's life. A few people present thought it was wrong to have a clown at a funeral, much less head the service. They murmured afterwards, that minister's out of his mind. He's crazy. But by all the proper canons of pastoral protocol, they were probably correct. But there he stood, acting as if God's joyful power had already defeated death. Was he crazy? Who can say? All we know is that Bill heard Jesus say, I am the resurrection and the life, and he acted accordingly. So here's the takeaway, right? Don't be afraid to jump into the role of disruptor like Jesus did, and act a little crazy from time to time. You're in good company. Should evil conspire against you, don't forget what Jesus said in today's gospel. You are my brother, and you are my sister, and you are my family when you do the will of God. And all God's people said, amen. Let's stand for the hymn of the day.
God, to pray for our communities, ourselves, and our world. You reawaken our hearts to your mercy. We give you thanks for renewers of the church in every age. Enliven the creativity and persistence of all seeking to transform the church into a closer vision of your beloved community. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Your presence is revealed in the shade of trees, the growth of seeds into flowers, and in the blessing of plants granting food in their right season. Heal lands scarred by deforestation, pollution, or infestation. Teach us to cultivate the earth with respect and reverence. Merciful God,
receive
our prayer. Our nations and communities are divided, O God. Teach us again to listen with curiosity and mercy, even in disagreement. Grant us the humility to acknowledge our hardness of heart and make us bold in modeling cooperation for the sake of the common good. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Hear the prayers of all who cry out to you from the depths of fear, despair, or hopelessness. With haste, rescue victims of trafficking, exploitation, and abuse, and bless organizations, individuals who work on their behalf. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Grant wisdom and clarity to all who are in seasons of discernment and transition. The three young people who affirmed their baptism today, graduates preparing for first jobs or new educational journeys, those who are shifting careers, and those who are navigating changes in their relationships. Accompany them with your peace. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Here, other intercessions may be offered, either aloud or in your heart.
Lord, we especially lift up those who have lost property and loved ones with all the inclement weather we've had across our country and around the globe. And we also pray for those in hot spots of conflict, especially the Middle East and Ukraine. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Praise to you for our ancestors in faith who believed, spoke, and lived in you. Give us confidence that as Jesus was raised, so we too will be raised with all the saints into your everlasting presence. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Receive our prayers, O God, and come quickly to our aid through the power of the Spirit and the love of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share that marvelous peace with one another.
Peace. Peace. Man, I had to start playing the drums because my heart was going one tempo and my knee was going another. And it's like going to
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, maker of all things. Through your goodness you have blessed us with these gifts. With them we offer ourselves to your service and dedicate our lives to the care and redemption of all that you have made. For the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord, Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray with confidence in the words our Savior gave us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of now and forever. Amen. Amen. Michael Card sings a song that is one of my favorites. It's called God's Own Fool, and I want to share some of the lyrics. It seems I've imagined him all of my life as the wisest of all humankind. But if God's holy wisdom is foolish to men, he must have seen out of his mind. For even his family said he was mad, and the priest said a demon's to blame. For God in the form of this angry young man could not have seemed perfectly sane. When we in our foolishness thought we were wise, he played the fool, and he opened our eyes. When we in our weakness believed we were strong, he became helpless to show us we were wrong. And so we follow God's own fool, for only the foolish can tell, believe the unbelievable, and come be a fool as well. In this supper, Jesus invites us into a very special fellowship where we become part of his merry group of troublemakers. And the way we find the strength for that is through his giving his very self to us, his body and blood, that we might be strengthened for this work of disruption. And so as you come forward today, I encourage you to think about Jesus' presence and how he helps to make all of us his holy fools. For the distribution, I invite you to come down the aisle to my right where I'll be waiting with the bread. After receiving the bread, there'll be identical stations on each side of me where you can receive wine or grape juice. The wine is the darker color, the grape juice is the lighter. If you prefer to take communion in your seat, we also have gluten-free wafers, little bits of bread, and small cups in the back, which you can take and have at your seat. Come, for all is now ready.
Sin
Please rise. And now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and preserve you. Amen.
Thankful hearts and
God has done. Let us seek the Lord, rejoice.
Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant that we who have received the sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
The congregation may be seated, and at this time I'd like to invite our graduates to come forward.
I graduated 8th grade.
From what school?
Orcutt Junior High.
And where are you headed next year?
Rigetti.
I graduated high school from Mompoc High, and next year I'll be at Cal Poly for mechanical engineering.
I graduated from the University of Hawaii at Manoa with a bachelor's degree of science in marine biology.
I graduated from St. Joseph High School, and I will be heading to CSU Long Beach in the fall for public health.
I graduated from UCSB last year with a good degree in psychological and brain sciences.
I graduated from Allen Hancock College with an associate in science in welding technology. Awesome.
I'd like to lift up a special prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this large group of graduates this year and the struggles that they've been through. We thank you that it's finally brought them to this place of celebration and feeling of having accomplished a great milestone. Be with them in this transition now as they move forward into a new future. Help them to remember that you are with them, guiding and directing their path and showing them the way. Amen.
Amen.
All right. I have a card for you, but it's and then if you want to take those, great. Another big thanks.
Look at that, we set off a car alarm.
Are there any birthdays or anniversaries? Oh. Somebody's celebrating out there.
Yes.
Where did the microphone go to?
It went out with the car alarm.
We'll wait for you.
You could lean over, dear, and share your mic.
I have a pretty loud voice. I probably don't need this. Yesterday was our anniversary, and it was number 62. We were married in 1962, and now we have been married 62 years. Woo-hoo! Woo!
Happy anniversary to you, happy anniversary to you. May the Lord bless and keep you, love and care for you too. Congratulations. Are there any announcements that folks would like to lift up? We'll start in the back with Joan. Behind you.
If you're going to PCPA this Friday, I have your tickets, so please see me before you leave. And on the 22nd Saturday, from 9 to 12, we're going to have an all-church cleanup day, and we could use all your help. We have lots of weeds that need pulling and maybe some dusting and organizing. So hopefully you can join us Saturday for even an hour if you can, and we'll have pizza afterwards.
Remember, one weed.
This Wednesday at 12 o'clock at the pantry will be the ladies' birthday lunch. I have seats for 12. They will set us when all 12 are there. So be there.
And back to PCPA. Greg and I will both drive, so we can handle 10 people. If you need someone to drive or you want to go with us, and that way you don't have to worry about that all the way to Sylvain, just let us know who we're taking.
Also, we have a sign-up sheet on the kiosk for special music this summer. So if you've got a gift, you want to play something, sing something, do something with another friend, please, please go and put your name down, and we'll be sure to include you in our worship. Also, this Wednesday is our confirmation picnic, so we need to talk about what people are bringing. Stick around for a minute, and we'll have that conversation. Great. Please stand for the blessing. May the steadfast love of God give you hope, the redeeming power of Christ give you courage, the abiding presence of the Spirit give you strength as you serve the will of God this day and every day. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.